Sunday morning, another day in paradise. Beautiful sunshine, clear blue skies. Check it out. This is California, man. It's a little crispy, like the air isn't real warm, but it's a beautiful day. Here's a better look at my garden in the light. So we've got these old brick walls that were put up before we bought the house, actually. And then we did this flagstone back here first, out the back door of the kitchen area where my cooking barbecue grill and stuff is. So just made it easy to come out the door and barbecue on bricks instead of this was, I forget what it was, clay tile or something. It was always muddy and it was mossy and green and ugh, it was a mess. So this is all the new work here. All this flagstone, they did a great job. It's real thick stuff too. I think I mentioned that when I was did one other video, the thickness of this stone is pretty incredible. That's what they put in right there. And that goes over to here, and then it joins with some other work we had done several years ago. This little bit, the walkway between the apartment where my mother-in-law lives and the main house we had done in the front steps to our house going in there. And then, well, anyway, another day in paradise, guys. I'm going to just get out in the garage and get started. I mentioned I wanted to do a little more work on the brake servo. Oh, here's a better look at the Honda I mentioned in that last video. This is an 86 that my mother-in-law has owned since it was brand new. Thing's in great shape. So I'm selling it for her right now because she stopped driving. She can't drive anymore. And it had some work done on it years ago. Darren, you'll probably recognize this. Look at the clear coat failure. Just peeling off along the edges. This door got banged, and so they repainted the door. And I think they painted all the way down to the quarter, so you can kind of see where they stopped. The color difference here, they painted right along there, and then a little blend here, and then down the sail panel, and then they went right to that body line right there. Didn't paint the trunk, just painted this quarter. And while most of the paint's held up pretty well, that particular area right along the edge of the door, they just didn't do a good job of prepping it, I guess, and it's just started to peel back. You can actually see it starting to fail even further back. But that's not my problem. The new guy will have to get that resprayed, I guess. I don't know what they would do, maybe. There's a little door ding there that's going to have to get fixed anyway, so maybe they'll just, like you do with your used cars, you know, give it a once over, one, two skidoo. But yeah, it's in really good shape. Nice. Tires are like brand new. And she had them put on a little while ago and then never drove it. She saw some TV article about, you're not supposed to use tires that are more than something, I can't remember, 4 or 5 years old. Some news report on ABC News got her all wound up about it. And I said, Mom, your tires are brand new. You haven't hardly used them. I mean, yes, they're old, but they haven't been sitting in the sun. They've been in the garage. What are you panicking about? But she went off and bought new tires. So car's got brand new tires. So here we are back at the bench. So that was yesterday's project, getting all that stuff put back together. So it's Sunday morning, and so I'm out in the garage again wearing a jacket because it's a little earlier today. I didn't get out here until after lunch yesterday, but today I'm going to be out here early. And today's the brake servo rebuild. I showed this all broken into pieces a little while ago. And here is the what I've sometimes confusingly... Oh, you can see those black lines or dark lines again. If I get too far under the fluorescent lights, they interfere with the video. They beat with the frame rate. So if I I apologize if those beet bars are annoying. I know they are for me, but I can't figure out how to get rid of them using this little camera here. But I'll probably just have to add a little more natural light in here, not fluorescent light, so that it would stop that beet. Maybe I'll turn on the quartz lamps and see if that helps. Bring a little more lamp light in there. So this is sometimes called the pedal box. It's sometimes I've referred to it as the servo, because this is the servo, actually. So that's the brake booster servo right there. The whole little, you know, rubber bellows deal adds the boost to the brake pedal assembly and mounts on this bracket down here. And this is really the pedal box. So you can see the two pedal levers that go down inside. I went over to my buddy's house the other day. I got a video on that, which I will add to this, that shows he actually helped me to make those little bushings that go in these pivot points. So there's one in here. There's one right inside there that's now made of stainless steel. I'd used copper pipe. And then there's a bigger one that was in here. And I had the original steel one, but he made me a stainless steel one. And he also fabricated a couple of these nylon bushings out of real nylon instead of whatever the plastic is that comes from the rebuild kit. So I've got some in here that are the white plastic, like this one here you can see. And then these here, which are the real nylon that my friend Dick made for me. Let me see if I can get this open and show you. Hang on a sec, I'll put the camera down for one sec. I notice a lot of us struggle with this idea of holding onto a camera and then trying to do stuff with one hand. There you go. So that's a good view of what the nylon looks like as compared to the white plastic. So this is the real deal. And then there you can see the stainless steel inner bushing. You can see the end of it right there. So that's a real deal made out of nylon, and I'm thinking that's probably one of the high wear points in my linkage. So I put it there just to be safe. So we're going to, today is put that back together. I'm going to have to, you know, take it apart a little bit to, you know, get all the components put back in the right places after I went to Dick's place. Oh, and something else that I discovered, I don't know, discovered, but something else I've been working on is I had to go buy replacement automotive style bushings. And these are the styles that have a tap end, what they call a tap end, that's meant to go down into a cast aluminum piece. And then they have the machine threaded end here. So this is an 18 threads per inch on the bottom and 24 threads per inch on the top, 5/16 inch diameter. And I needed to buy a whole bunch of these, and I was looking in the auto parts stores for these, which they sell, you know, for intake manifolds and whatever, but they're all too long, and I needed some really shorty ones. And when I was at Dick's the other day, we were talking about maybe I could make some out of stock, and turned out I found a bag that I had stashed away of all the threaded studs that that were in the car. And I put them in a plastic bag and labeled them, 5/16 threaded studs, various lengths. And I had all the ones I needed, so I didn't need to go buy. But I bought a couple boxes of these things. This one here is 1-inch overall length from a company called AVECO. AVECO. Is that registering? I don't think I can quite focus on it for you to be able to read it. And I bought these from an online web store because every time I went to local AutoZone or O'Reilly Auto Parts or any of those guys, I mean, these things were like $1.50 for two of them. And I bought that entire box of 10 for, I think, $4. So that was a better deal. But as it turns out, I actually saved the originals, so I'm going to reuse the originals. So let me get you guys set up, and I'll append just a minute. I'll put you on a a floor stand, so I'm not wiggling it all around.
So this is my friend Dick Vandermaiden, who's got all kinds of tools in his shop, and he's turning out some nylon bushings that go in the brake linkage for his cars. And he was the one kind enough to help me with the steel bushing that I needed that I told you guys about a minute ago. So here's a little look around his shop. He's got all kinds of tools. That's a Bridgeport mill. Looks like a CNC controller over here. Insulation for future work, it looks like. drill press here. Radial arm saw. More automated machine tools over here. This looks like a CNC mill. That'd probably turn out almost any kind of part you'd want. Dick's got another Series 1 Jaguar here. This is the same body style as mine, but his car, he said, this is just a body shell. He bought just the shell from a guy who wanted a Ford engine out of it. Somebody had stuck a Ford engine in it, so he wanted to buy it. But you can see here he's got leftover engine blocks from, looks like an XJ6 back there. That's another lower block. I don't know what that is. There's another Jaguar back here. This is a Series 2, maybe, XJ6. It's hard to say what year that is. You can see the taillights. That's kind of the old-fashioned look. Another CNC controller here. Several of them, actually, it looks like. He bought a machine shop that was going out of business. Look at all the machine tools, fixtures, all kinds of stuff. Man, look at this. Here's some intake manifolds for various different Jag cars, bell housings. Plumbing fixtures back there for some reason. Oh, more engines down below. There's, let me see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 engines on the shelf down below there. There's a press, hydraulic press. I don't know what this stuff is over here. Hey, Dick, what's this big monster with the funnel on top?
Coffee roaster.
That's a coffee roaster. Look at that. He roasts his own coffee in here. Nice.
That was 25 pounds of coffee in 15 minutes.
Wow.
I used to have a buddy that built these things, but he was not knowledgeable.
Built the coffee roasters?
Yeah, he built the mechanical machine, but he had no notion about the electrical control. So I built the electrical control for him.
Oh, that's interesting. Yeah, I noticed you've got stacks and stacks of controllers. Around the back side there on that wall, there's like 2 8-foot racks full of...
No, that's all terrestrial microwave.
Oh, that's microwave equipment. I thought it was machine control.
No, that used to carry conversations.
I see, okay. Well, what are you saving that for?
Who knows? There's a lot of gold in it, believe it or not.
Gold, yeah, that's true. You can recover the precious metals.
Yeah.
Okay, more later, guys.
Okay, good morning. You're going to see my hands in this video, not too much else. I'm going to be working on the brake servo, brake pedal box assembly, which we talked about. I put a couple videos up there already. Progress I've made since the last time I started this video was I was missing some of these bushings that go through these pivot points, and the 5/16 inch bolt that slides through is covered in a bushing, and that bushing is very tight, you know, nice snug. I mean, it's not tight, but it's a very little clearance. So that becomes the pivot point, this bushing, and it rides inside these nylon inserts. And I didn't have the right one. I made one out of copper, and one of my comments on the video was, you know, that copper is going to react with the steel with the galvanic reaction. You're going to end up with corrosion in there. It's not going to work. And you know, sure enough, I believe he was right, or that comment, I forget who came from, but I appreciate the comment. And so I talked to a couple other friends, and I have a Jag owner's discussion group, a text-based, not video-based discussion group, and I posted there. And one of those guys, who's a friend of mine, invited me to come up to his machine shop, and he turned out two bushings for me, the one that goes in this pivot point here and the one that goes in this pivot point here. And he made them out of stainless steel, so now I have the perfect answer to what was at one point kind of a problem for me, and now I'm not really too concerned about it. It looks great, and it should work great. So a couple of other things. I think I mentioned last time I was working on this in front of you guys, there's a part right here that goes in this lever, which has an eccentric hole in this barrel shaft, so it's off center. And when you rotate it, it creates, you know, this sort of motion that would drive this lever to be offset in one direction or the other from the main power setting. That's important because there's a little button down here in the servo that the main lever pin, which you see here, goes through that hole, and this little button here is the pressure relief valve for the bellows to either be under vacuum or open to the air. So as you apply the brake, you want that lever to be pressed on this button in order to close the valve and cause the vacuum to begin to add power assist to the action of the brake lever. Okay, great. So this is an adjuster, and it was a very difficult part to find, and I actually struggled for some time because I thought I'd lost it. And so I found one on eBay, and I bought it for some stupid number, I can't remember, $38 or something. And guess what I found in the bin of plated parts that I was digging through the other day? Yep, there it is, and mine's actually in better shape, so I'm going to use this one. I replated it in zinc, so it's going to be corrosion protected a little bit, and it's just going to look better. So this one is going to go back on eBay, maybe, something like that. I've got little bits of wet or dry sandpaper that I keep in this box over here that I use to just polish up things. So I'm going to just give this a little clean up before I put it back in, because it's got a little nastiness started right on the surface there from sitting around in the garage for the last few months when I did my electroplating video. I'd done a whole bunch of electroplating at once, and you know, once you get that system, that kit set up and fired up, you know, I just try to do as much stuff as I possibly can, because it's just easier that way to get it all done at once. And this was one of the things I grabbed, and probably it was in the right place, labeled bag or whatever, and when I took it back out, I just piled it in a bag with a bunch of other stuff, intending to put it back where it belonged, and I didn't. Lesson learned. Somebody told me once when I started this project, they said, don't assume you're going to remember where stuff goes just because you did when you took it off, because your brain cannot remember that much detail. And I will attest that that is absolutely correct. You take something apart and you swear you're going to remember where everything goes because it's just so obvious to everybody. Wrong. I'll also point out that when I found that little eccentric nut, the piece that I made out of copper the other day, which goes into this shorter piece, guess what I found? The original, which I also zinc plated, so it's nice and bright. So now I have a spare. I have a copper one and a steel one, and I don't need either one at this point, because now I have those stainless steel ones, which are perfect. So okay, enough. Lessons learned, huh? So, let's see. I think step number one is I'm just going to put the servo on the bracket. Oh, that's right. I want to tighten up the bracket. I put this just loosely, finger tight, on here. I put those new studs, the studs I found, in there. And these four bolts need to be tightened up. Nuts, I mean, need to be tightened up. Get my three-quarter socket set out, and I think that's 7/16, isn't it? What a beautiful mess. Nope, half inch. Yep, it's half inch.
Using all brand new nylon lock washers, because somebody told me once that it wasn't good to reuse those. You should only use them once, and you know, they weren't that expensive. I bought bags of them from one of those online fastener stores. I can't even remember which one I used for these, but I bought them quite a while ago, and just starting to come in handy now as I put things back together. I don't really know how tight to crank those down. I don't think they need to be super tight, but I don't want them to come off either, but we'll see. Let's call it hand tight rather than putting my whole body into it. Okay. It's kind of awkward to work on this thing because it doesn't lay flat. It's got so many little weird protuberances. All right, now this could be a little interesting. I'm not sure how I'm going to get that in there. Is it going to slide in, or am I going to need to? I think I'm going to need to take things apart to get it in there. That's a bummer, but c'est la vie. Take this side lever assembly off. Belleville washer, spacer, flat washer, rubber buffer, flat washer. I really don't want to take that pedal arm out of here because I've got that spring on, and taking that spring off and on again is a pain in the butt. So I'm hoping I can pull just this assembly up off of the pedal arm, which I think I can. It should come up. Nothing else holding it that I can see. Maybe a little persuasion is in order. Save all these little plastic cups from various different dairy products and stuff we buy, sour cream and... Okay, well that's coming off the rubber buffer. Okay. Now why is that on there so tight? He says that's just... Wow, it's moving but slow. What I need is like a leather hammer, but I don't have one. I'm going to switch over to a steel hammer with a little block of wood. I've got a little lightweight hammer I like to use for stuff like this because it doesn't get too heavy-handed. I keep a box of scraps of blocks of wood lying around just for these occasions when you need a little persuasion, but you don't want too much. Just enough. Just enough. Okay, so this is the levers. That's one heck of a concoction. I think I mentioned this to you guys once before. So these are the two brake cylinder push rods out here where my fingers are. This is a pivot point, and you apply the brake pedal to here, which rotates like so, which forces this backward and forces those to go forward. So you're pushing in on the servo, which is going to help pull, and you're pressing out on the master cylinders, which are mounted on the front of the bracket. Yeah, that's really funny. So good news is I got that out of the way for now. So let me just set that there. Now I can put the servo on without taking that brake pedal off, which I really didn't want to do. Technically, it's the clutch pedal that has the sorry, I'll finish my thought. The brake pedal, the clutch pedal is the one that has that spring in it. Oh, this is a bummer. You know what? Okay, so lesson learned. I should have done this in the opposite order and mounted the servo to the bracket and the bracket to the brake pedal housing in that order. So now I'm a smarter. I wouldn't have had to take that lever off. You guys are watching real-time stupidity, but what are you going to do? That's the way it goes. So, you see what's happening here? They're pulling. It's pulling the studs out rather than taking the nuts off. I don't really care, I guess, if we get the job done one way or the other. Works both ways. Alrighty. So let's go this way. Put those on. Pieces over here in another little tub. That bag of nuts I told you guys I bought. No, I don't think so, Quickstraw. See? It is correct. So I said it was a beautiful day here, and it's going to be, but right now it's a little chilly. My nose is running from the cold weather, from the cold air, and handling the tools, which are kind of cold. You see me rubbing my hands at the beginning of the video. One of the things that I was working on this morning was putting annotations, little text-based comments in my videos from yesterday, the Saturday. There were six different videos, and each one included some moments where things were happening where I wasn't speaking loud enough. I didn't think, anyway, I couldn't hear myself. And so I added some text comments. I kind of like that. I think that's a neat idea. And it's really easy to do in the YouTube video editor. You just click on Edit Annotations, and it gives you the ability to watch the video. And at any given moment, you can click on one of the features, whether you have it be a speech pop-up bubble or a text note box that you can place in overlay on the video at any point. And then continue on, watch the video until the next spot you want to make a comment. And I always wondered how people were doing that, and I just found it the other day. It's really easy to use, and it's built into the YouTube video editor for free. So if you don't know how to do it, check it out. You just go to your video manager page, click on a video, and then open that. When that video opens, there's a button at the top that says Edit Annotations. Or maybe it's not a button. It may be just a text clickable text box. But it was pretty cool. I liked it. I'm also struggling with the video editor right now in YouTube that I used to be able to stabilize my videos by clicking on that. You go into the video editor mode, and then you click on the sort of an effects button, I think it is, or some kind of, I forget what it was called, but one of the buttons at the top of the video was, you know, do some processing, so you can color correct, you can increase the contrast, and you can stabilize the video for handheld spots in the video where the camera is shaking around because you're moving your hands or doing whatever. It flattens all that out, smooths it out, makes it real easy to watch. Well, what's been happening to me is the minute I hit that stabilize button, the video is running at normal speed, but the audio slows way down. And you can like this. I was like, what the heck's going on? And I wasn't really able to get it to work. I've tried 3 or 4 times now, so the only thing I can assume is one of the, it's a bug, I guess, in the video editor. Alrighty, now let's see if we can make this work. This is a slightly different approach, coming in from above and dropping it on there. How's that working? A little too snug, so that means I gotta loosen these up a bit. I guess it'll work. Just give myself a little more clearance at the bottom here. It's not gonna pull apart because this is too. The plate's too stiff. So I'll give myself a little room on all four of them. Good thing I'm not getting paid by the hour, huh, guys? There we go. Love it. These suckers back in now. Okay, gotta have two hands. Two hands, and they're cold. It's a little tough. Darren, I think you live in warm weather, so most of the time, right? But it's been so cold in Florida. You're probably suffering more than you normally do because of the cold weather, huh? Come on. Shouldn't have been that complicated. Yeah, Greg, you live in cold weather too, and then, my gosh, you know, nothing compared to what Shut Your Face or HPR or Rick Fix live with, or Ron at the Wrecking Yard. Those guys are all freezing. They're right. Well, actually, it's not that cold, but they live in cold weather. I grew up in cold weather. I don't miss it at all. bring these up snug to make sure everything's still happy. It's kind of funny the way this goes together, that you have to kind of do it halfway in one direction and halfway in the other. Meaning put the bracket onto the back of the servo, but not tighten it up all the way. Slide it over the back of the brake pedal housing and then tighten everything up after that, but whatever. Welcome to working on old cars. There you go. So now that's in place, and you can begin to get a sense for how that brake pedal lever is supposed to work. I don't think it's supposed to hit that, though, is it? Maybe. I don't know. It's hard to say. I need a... I'm going to give you guys a little snapshot here of the... I've got you on a pedestal, so it's a little hard to move this thing around. But you see that drawing up there on top of my workbench? If I can get it in there. No, I can't. Maybe I can this way. I've got a drawing up there on the wall, and it shows me how this whole thing goes together, so I'm using that. I'm going to try to take a picture of that and edit it into the video so you get a little sense of what I'm faced with. That gets held back just a little bit by the linkage. Yep, that's what happens. Okay. I'm not quite sure what I need to do. Apply the brake lever. Okay, there we go. I can squeeze this. We're going to put our rubber buffer in there. First thing that went on, got a little flat washer. And the spacer. Belleville washer. Okay, down here I gotta get this nylon bushing in. Dick would say it's not nylon, it's some other, if I could break them, which I did, I broke a couple of these, and my friend Dick said, then they're not nylon, if you broke it, there's no way to break It's a nylon by hand or with a screwdriver. You can bend it, but you can't break it. That's being quite stubborn. Okay. Start again. There's one on the bottom side here too. Actually, it's an old one, so I think I'll take it off and put a new one on because I got a spare. Dick made me a couple out of nylon, so I got a couple spares. Here's how I broke them when I was dry fitting this and putting these bushings on. I snapped them trying to lift them off. So here's an old one, and here's a new one. So just stained with grease and oil and whatever, but you know, this is the, let's say, clear plastic, white plastic, and those other ones I showed you earlier are the ones that are more made of that Dick made of real nylon. Pushing it right back out. Boy, that's tricky. I need a little something to go over that. I'm going to get a socket. I have them right here. Almost down. That one's set. If you don't succeed at first, try again. I think there should be a flat washer on the outside here too. And I don't have one. Nope. I've been using up all my washers because I didn't buy a bag of washers. I probably should have. Fits, but it's gross. Bucket of washers, various sizes from the car. So we're going to be looking for something that'll fit this application here. Looks good. Needs a little cleaning. Not too much. I'm just going to wire wheel it. Excuse the noise. Put a little twist ties around some of the ones that are all the same size so I don't have to go hunting constantly for pairs or couples that need to go together. So that one I can put back in there. Okay, what did I do with the nut? There it is. Probably not so tight that I can't adjust it with the eccentric barrel nut, so we want to make sure that's still doable. Yeah, that one's quite a bit smaller. So that's the way it looks when it gets put together. This pin goes through here, and that little assembly has a retention spring that goes on it, and a flat washer and a lock nut. Again, this flat washer needs a little dress. Excuse me one sec for the noise. Corrosion on it from sitting around like the other ones. I've plated this, but the plating doesn't last forever in a damp, cold garage. That's okay. And there you have it, don't we? I'm gonna crank this one down. I don't think I need to. Okay, so taking a look from the business side, there's the brake cylinder push rods. There's my pivot point, which will go on the bracket, and the brake pedal. Applying pressure in that direction. All looks good. So I aligned this linkage according to an unmolested brake pedal box assembly that I saw at my friend's Dick's house. Sorry, I'm holding it up too high. And the important lines to note here is the line on the backside of this pedal, this power lever, they call it, the brake pedal lever, and the line on the back of the actual brake pedal arm were nearly the same, just ever so slightly different. So this one is running kind of in that direction. Let me see if I can get something here to illustrate. So it's running in that direction, and the brake pedal lever is running in kind of that orientation. So I hadn't noticed it at the other shop, but maybe more along this line here. So if you're trying to install this brake pedal lever on the splined shaft that goes through, you have a number of choices on where that shaft will be in relationship to the two pins that are on this arm that you're pivoting. And I just took my lead from the other device, so it was ever so slightly off from that angle in just one spline, and that's where I placed it. So that should be correct. If anybody's following this to build a pedal box, it's a good place to start. I've read about somebody who had been working on one and had installed and uninstalled it multiple times in order to try and get that pedal lever in a place that felt comfortable inside the car for your foot and didn't interfere with the operation of the assembly, the linkages. So I'm hoping that this one's going to turn out okay. It's a little unclear to me. I haven't built one before, so that's the direction I'm headed in. Okay, the next step would be normally to install the bracket that holds all of this stuff in alignment with one another. But I believe that I have to do that on the car itself, because if I go much further than this, I'll end up having to take it all apart again in order to put the parts on the car. So I think I've taken this about as far as I can go. So that concludes my brake pedal box and, well, it's brake and clutch pedal box and booster servo rebuild videos. And if there's any questions on this stuff, feel free to PM me and I'll be happy to answer those questions for you when I can. I don't think there's anything else I can show you here. These pieces are all that's left to go on, which is the pin bolt that goes through the bracket here, which will then capture this pivot point here in the bracket and allow that whole assembly to go together in that orientation. So other than that, I think we're all set. So good talking to you guys. See you later.